treat myself if I thought I was sacred? How would I love myself if nothing was wrong? I'd be in the
Hi Muriel, I'm really, really pleased that I was able to come down to Glastonbury today and have a chat with you. And I just wanted to say a few words before we get started. Now you sing these beautiful spiritual songs, which we'll be sharing a lot about in their background and what your inspiration's been with the listeners in a few minutes. Mm-hmm. But just to briefly put this into context, I met you, or I experienced you singing your music for the first time about 6-7 years ago. I think it was in Chan as well, at a private party, and I was really taken by the music that you were singing there, and bought your first album. and it was a few years later, when our family moved to Dublin, that I bumped into you again when you were doing a venue with Neil Donald Walsh. And there were quite a few technical hitches, unexpectedly, in that event. And you were on the stage singing there again, which was lovely. So it's so nice to connect with you again back in Glastonbury. And we're going to spend the next, see how long it develops. I'll have a nice long chat together about you and your music and your influences. So thanks very much, Muriel, for having me.
Pleasure. Thank you for your interest.
Great. And how would you describe yourself?
Straight into the deep end. How would I describe myself? I would say, well, it's so funny. I was, when you asked me before we were doing the little check about yogi tea, and you said, why do I like yogi tea? And watching it playing back, I realised that a lot of those qualities I like about myself. I said, what I like about yogi tea is it's sweet and natural. but it's comforting without any of the sugary stuff.
Right.
So I think in my essence, I'm a very, I'm a sweet person. I've got a very sensitive heart and can be very empathic to things that are going on in the world and life, and feel such a call to try and bring comfort, I suppose, to situations where people are going through hard times, and just do whatever I can to bring a bit of relief.
Well, that definitely comes across in your music, doesn't it? This sweetness and giving people the comfort and everything being very heart-centered, connecting with source within. So I would definitely agree with you with that. So I realize that perhaps you haven't always sung, Muriel. I mean, people know you as a singer, but could you perhaps give us some background? What were the earlier influences? What was it that actually brought you onto the path of becoming a spiritual singer?
Gosh, well, it was definitely a long journey from probably about the age of 4 or 5, starting to learn musical instruments. So starting with the recorder, and then a few years later I tried the guitar, but it was quite big for me. It's quite a big instrument for a small child, and I really struggled with it. And I was really drawn to playing the flute from seeing the other girls at the music school who were doing flute. So I ended up doing flute for 6 years. And then all through that kind of era as well, I mean, this is between about the ages of 5 and 15, 16, I was always singing in the school choir as well. Just loved music, and just any opportunity like that to be a part of a group making music together, I really
So does
enjoyed.
That mean your parents were very musical then, I'm guessing? Were
well,
they?
Not hugely. I mean, they both at different times learnt to play a little bit of piano, but as adults, they had lessons, and I think in their early 20s, with piano, and they both have a very strong appreciation of music. I mean, we had often, classical music playing on the radio a lot when I was growing up, so I learnt to just appreciate, I suppose, the beauty of a lot of pieces.
So music was always there and part of your life, so
Yeah, it was. Yeah. But at the same time, because it was always there kind of as just an enhancer of your environment, or as a little pleasure, it wasn't seen as a vocation as well. It was seen as a hobby.
Okay.
But I never had the idea, for example, that I could be a professional musician as a career. Mm. And especially because the kind of models of music careers that I'd been shown were more orchestral, and the kind of the more traditional musical roles, and that just didn't appeal to me in some ways. I wanted a bit more freedom to be a bit more creative rather than always have to play the dots on the page.
Yeah, so your parents were never, they never stepped forward and sort of pushed you into a musical career or anything?
No,
in that
not
sense.
At all.
Right,
not
yeah.
at all. It was always me who was kind of like, I want to do this, or
nice.
Can I do that?
Uh-huh.
And then they would just mum diligently, you know, week after week, bringing me to music lessons. And all, you know, all the cost involved with music lessons over the years as well. It's quite a big investment for a parent. But and sometimes my parents think, well, you know, they did, you know, were a bit concerned at one point. You know, you've had all this training in flute and you just don't play the flute anymore, for example. But I have no doubt that learning instruments is just, they can be such a stepping stone to, you know, all these musical skills and things that are developing in your brain and in your spirit as you're playing music are just, you know, not to be underestimated. And I mean, it was near the end of 6 years of flute that it was very clear there was the kind of two ways that it could go. You could either kind of really stay at the relative level where I was, or it was become a very serious musician, do the orchestra thing. And and at that point, it was about then that I just had the sense of I was frustrated that I couldn't sing at the same time as I was playing my flute. So I seemed to reach a threshold within myself where I was just done with one instrument because the other was really
ready to come
forth.
Out. Yeah, sure, the voice.
Exactly.
Beautiful.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But I mean, that said, you know, once I'd left school, the whole schooling system, I mean, I went to university and I didn't find the same kinds of opportunities to be part of music as I had throughout my schooling years. So I wasn't part of any choirs anymore and I wasn't playing the flute. So I had about 3 years of my life where I was really barren of any kind of musical expression. And when I look back on those years as well, they were more difficult for me. I think I was more depressed in some ways and just didn't have as much fun. And and it wasn't until my early 20s when I went to learn meditation in a spiritual community, and we were meditating on a really regular basis, that it just seemed to just come out. I was just really reminded what a part of me music is, and it would just overflow out. There was no stopping it.
Oh, super. Lovely. I'd love to hear a bit from you, Muriel, about how you actually came to make your first recordings, how your first album actually came to be.
Gosh, well, my very first recordings, I suppose, which depends how far back you go. I mean, when I was 14, a friend and I used to ring up the radio stations and sing to the DJs, and we would always record ourselves doing this, and we'd kind of get freebies for it. But no, proper recordings, like to share, like in albums, I think was in about 2002, when I was living in the esoteric community, and there was another young man there who was very interested in music, and he had some recording equipment, so he basically said, I'll help you out with a session if you want to do a few songs. So I put my first four songs down, and it was literally guitar and voice, and at the same time there was no recording one and then the other, so you know, you really had to get the whole
thing right
through to the end of the song. And I remember sometimes like getting almost to the end of the song and then I'd play a bum chord and to start all over again. And I remember though listening back to those recordings and just going, wow, is that my voice? And just being like, wow, it sounds like the radio voices. But it's so funny, you know, because when I listen to it now, it's full of bad tuning, you know, it's flat and it's sharp. But I suppose maybe what I was hearing was like the effect that, say, things like reverb, you know, these different qualities can how they can enhance your voice and bring out certain tones and things, and that's what I was really hearing and excited about. And it was the following year that I suppose I got together with another couple of musicians, and we went actually into a recording studio and recorded about, I think, 7 or 8 tracks. And that was just the most fun thing I'd ever done in my life, I think, pretty much up until that point. Because we could record things just one instrument at a time, and you watched the layers building up, and if you didn't do it right, it was fine. You just had to do that little bit again, and and then to listen to the overall effect of what we'd created with just adding a little bit here and a little bit there, making this big sound, was just really exciting.
Magic.
Really exciting, yeah.
Yeah, wonderful.
Yeah, it was. My first kind of, professional album, though, you know, that wasn't until about 2007, quite a few years later, where I was working with a recording producer in Glastonbury, and he had the real kind of expertise and the know-how to kind of get a really good solo recording done. So
what was that album actually called, Muriel?
Well, that one was Angelica.
Right.
Yeah, and before then, I think probably the first album that you'd ever bought from me, you know, back in Chalice Wells 6 years ago, would have been one called Synergy, which was, again, like, recorded locally in Glastonbury, but in literally in somebody's bedroom, you know, with one guy helping me out with a little laptop and really primitive recording gear, or just, you know, the basic all you need kind of stuff.
But it's strange, isn't it? Because there was I mean, I was the customer. I bought the CD, and I was perfectly happy with what you were perceiving as something basic done in someone's back room. So it just shows you, doesn't it? I have the same thing with me as an artist, and you have this perception of your work, don't you? And this idea of it needing to be perfect, thinking of the quality, you put it out there, but it's about the energy. And I mean, I know that's very true with your music. I mean, it's the energy that people tune into, and not the polished, finished product, isn't
exactly
it?
Yeah. And that's exactly the conclusion that I got to at some point, was, you know, it wasn't perfect to me, to my ears, but it was good enough to be out there helping people, or, you know, for people to enjoy, and you know, to let your own perfectionism kind of hold back that gift is just a bit selfish, really. You know, it doesn't really matter, like you say, people don't necessarily want the full polished perfect result, as long as there's a real quality in there that they're receiving something from. So so yeah, I mean, even my, you know, latest album now is you know, years on now, is I wouldn't call it perfect myself. You know, I still listen, and sometimes I hear little bits that make me go, oh god, but, you know, there's enough energy in there that it will, you know, move people to tears on the right day, you know, when it's the song that they need to hear and stuff. So I'm not so worried about all of those little things, because you could spend years and years and years trying to perfect an album, and during that time evolve so much yourself that you'd never get it finished.
That's
so
right,
at some point
you
do just have to draw the line, really.
That's a really fascinating point you brought up there, because I know that applies to me as well, and I'm sure to lots of other people in different areas in life, where you have to recognise when something's finished, when it's ready to go out there, when you're not overdoing. It's like with a painting as well, when no more brush strokes, that's it, put it out. And same thing with music, I'm guessing.
That's it. Well, I think I got to the point as well where I was done. I was full of the album. I'd reached my own limit of how much I was willing or able to work any more on it without going insane.
Yeah. Oh, lovely. So after you brought out your first album, Muriel, you know, you were suddenly a serious musician, a serious singer, so to speak. Did you notice that this changed anything for you in your life?
Well, I noticed, well, to some extent, I didn't, the first recordings didn't make me feel like a serious musician, just because of the sheer amount of people, the technology now, and, you know, ever since the last maybe 10 years, the technology's become so accessible that there are, you know, literally millions of people around the world recording in their bedrooms the whole time. But I think the fact that, I think more than the first recordings, there was one first song in particular, Sacred, which I did record at that time, but it got such strong feedback from people that it made me realise that there was something in the music which was worth working towards getting out there more, that it was good to strive to share it on a wider scale. And it changed my commitment to the music. It deepened my intention to, and my desire to get the music out there, because I could see the effect that it was having on people. Mm-hmm. And people were literally telling me how important the song was and that the world needed to hear it. So started to, I suppose that combined with the recordings helped to reinforce my seeing myself as a musician, because up until that point I didn't.
Right, okay, yeah. That's an important point, isn't it? So you became more visible to you, basically.
Exactly. Yeah. And it was, the revelation of the fact that, that the music was coming through meditation.
Mm.
You know, when you're meditating, you're really connecting with your own essence. So the fact that this was pouring out when I was in that kind of space was just showing me how much of a part of myself music really was, and to share it.
So do you think then that this music, you singing, expressing yourself from the heart, this is your true mission in life, would you say?
I'd say it's one of them. I'd say, I probably have a mission in life, and music is one particular way that I can realise that. And, there are other things that I like to do as well, which are just different ways of maybe achieving a similar end result.
Mm, yeah. Now, for those people who haven't had a chance to look at your website yet, Muriel, and we will be sharing the details later, there is a section on there, a gallery, where you have lots of photos of you from venues with well-known faces from the spiritual world, self-development. I was wondering if you'd like to share with us any particularly memorable experience, anyone you worked with.
Mm. I'd say for me the most meaningful and memorable was working with Neil Donald Walsh, and partly because of what that meant in my own personal journey. Before I even went to live in this spiritual community, so I'd just finished university and I was working, very conventional office job for the council, and I got I had a 3-week house sit, and I remember at that time reading Conversations with God by Neil Donald Walsh, and I only bought the book because when I was in the bookshop I used kinesiology, so muscle testing, to ask, life, which books would you recommend, or should I get this time? And I got Conversations with God, and I got A Course in Miracles, which I still haven't read. But reading through this book, I remember sitting in this house, that I was just didn't even really know, and sitting on the sofa, but getting so engrossed in this book, which, as I read it, I could feel things happening, in my heart, and up until that time I'd never had any kind of experiences of my own energy field, of my own, I knew there were theories about having a heart chakra, but it was like, wow, I actually have a heart chakra, because I could feel things going on which were so strong and so uplifting and full of joy and light as I read the material, that it really just resonated at such a deep level with me. And I was just full of admiration for Neil Donald Walsh, for his journey, and for sharing his insights in such a accessible and easy to understand and digest format, very light and conversational. So it just blew my mind when a few years later, maybe 5 or 6 years later, I was in Glastonbury and I met Tim Wheater.
Yes.
And again, following a real little synchronicity and an intuition, it was that I met Tim, and he said, well, let's have a look at, he got out this wall chart and said, let's look at my gigs, what's coming up. And he said, oh, we're doing Neil Donald Walsh in Bristol in a few weeks. Maybe you could come along to that. And because they were performing kind of as the audience were all walking in. And so just even to come along to that and hear Neil speak in person and to hear his story from his own mouth was just incredible. And I ended up doing that retreat which followed that weekend.
Right.
And I think it was, it wasn't at that particular retreat, but the following year, kind of they had the mailing list of everybody who'd been on that retreat. And there was a follow-up retreat the following year, and it was at that one that my music first got played. Which led to being asked to do a kind of couple of UK tours with Neil and the organisers. And so if somebody back in those days in New Zealand during my house sit had said, you'll one day sing with this man in Europe or, in England, it just would have blown my mind to think of the possibility. I mean, and it just gives me a real appreciation for, you just don't know where you're going, really.
Yeah.
And you just take life one step at a time, and you just never know where you're going to end up and what kind of amazing, wonderful, wonderful experiences lie ahead, and to really, I suppose that's shown me as well, not to necessarily look out for just music opportunities, or but just to follow what your interest is, you know, to always keep involved in areas and things that interest me, and those things will naturally lead to forums to share my music naturally. And and so I guess that not everything is always what it seems, or you know, you can't consciously control and create opportunities like that. You just have to kind of follow your bliss.
That's exactly, and I was just going to say that.
And then you'll end up being exactly where you're meant to be.
I agree with what you're saying there, this idea of it would be almost foolish, wouldn't it, to just be looking for the musical, obviously musical opportunities, as you say, opening a door, turning over a stone, just taking it step by step, because you really never know, do you?
You don't.
What's waiting around the next corner.
That's
when you open
it.
The door, answer the phone, speak to someone.
That's
what's
it.
What's waiting there for you? Oh, we've got canine.
Canine intervention.
So you mentioned a few minutes ago that when I was asking you about your mission, and you saw music as being an integral part of that, so to speak, but you do have other things that you devote your life to. What are some of these other things that you spend your time doing, Muriel?
Well, probably the main other thing at the moment is a lot of work around flower essences. So I don't know if you're familiar, or if people out there are familiar, but you know, you may have heard of rescue remedy, or the bark flower, the batch flower remedies, and these are made basically, they're energetic infusions of plants, of trees, of flowers most of the time, kind of imprinted in water, and then, you know, the particular qualities of those plants will get absorbed by your own energy field and help to kind of dissolve any, you know, particular things on the different levels that might not be serving you, or to enhance and strengthen other qualities that you do need at the time. And so I work at I'm still, it's funny, you know, back at the time that I gave the concert at the Chalice Well, I was just, you know, a local musician, but now I'm actually an employee as well, and kind of coordinate the flower essences project there, which is just such lovely work. I mean, there's such special energies in that garden. They're really strong. I think it's much stronger than I think most other places that I've been in, or had the privilege of experiencing so far. And I also work with a friend of mine, Casey. We're kind of currently making a range of essences as well. So that's hopefully coming out in about the next 6 months or year as well.
Exciting. So if someone had no experience of these flower essences that you make, how would you introduce them to the whole concept of flower essences? What did that actually get used for, Muriel?
Well, I think the beauty of flower essences is that they can work on kind of the most fundamental level of our being, on our energy. And I think, you know, over the last 5-10 years, there's been a lot more understanding about the idea that energy follows thought, for example, and I'm a believer that a lot of the problems that we encounter in our own being start at the level of thought, for example, or at the energetic level, and they can kind of be with us a long time before they're even experienced as an emotion or as a physical kind of symptom. And the amazing thing about these essences is, because they themselves are like an electromagnetic remedy, they work straight at that deepest level of our bodies, and kind of can clear all of that stuff out and target it before it becomes anything really serious or physical. And so it's just, yeah, they're just such a gift of nature, really. And you know, I'm just have so much awe and appreciation for nature, and believe that nature is always there, kind of willing to support us if we're just willing to get out and go for a walk, and to receive, to ask for what we need, and just be open to whatever form that kind of healing or guidance can come in. You know, nature is so full of metaphor and as well as just beautiful feeling and upliftment, that there's so much to experience and receive. And I suppose, you know, you could get all of that directly from nature, but a lot of the time people in their lives are not making the time or do not have that time and or cannot access a particular plant, for example, that might have just the thing that they need. So that's where essences can really help to bring nature to people and kind of keep that connection.
Now you've recorded your second official studio album, haven't you, Muriel? And as is very often the case, musicians tend to have a message that they want to share, don't they, when they bring out these bodies of music. So how does this second album differ from the first one? What is the new message you're bringing through with this music?
Gosh, well, with the first album, I really had an intention to bring as many kind of inspirational or uplifting songs as possible on there. Just, you know, there's enough sadness in the world, there's enough sad songs on the radio, let's just inspire people. So there's a lot of that in the first one. And the second one, I felt like I wanted to include some of the songs that I'd written over the years that were at, you know, really deep times for me that weren't necessarily happy, but they were times that I had to go through, or they, a sadness might have pointed to a great love, for example, and how you can kind of alchemize those situations into better feelings. And so yeah, the second one has got more kind of tones, more shades of emotion in it, I'd say, than just the upliftment and the inspiration. It's kind of more reflective of a whole person and the real true everyday life experience rather than just the highs.
So you're seeing a whole person. Do you think when you came to record it that was reflecting you? Had you become much more whole when you made this album?
I think potentially, yeah, maybe I was more at peace with certain sides of myself, or with the nature of life, that it doesn't always have to be happy, you know, that the downs are a part of life and necessary, you know, for growth. You know, you learn so much about yourself and what's important to you through those times where you're missing something or feeling less than happy.
Yeah, sure.
So, I mean, in a nutshell, I see kind of the essence of the first album is very much like appointed to divinity. You know, there's always love there within yourself that you can just turn to and receive whenever you need it, and you're never alone in that sense, and you have all that you need within yourself. And to remember how glorious that is and what a gift it is. And the second one is more also like there is that there, but you might also find these parts that are not so light filled, that don't feel as good, and that's all perfect too. That, you know, you can be the whole of yourself, to just be who you really are, you know, show your real face to the world and to yourself, and that's where, you know, your peace will lie at the end of the day. Have much more freedom to be a whole person rather than just a spiritual one, or, you know, one that's constantly connected to that love and divinity, because, yeah, there are plenty of times, you know, where we fall so short of that, and that's fine, that's okay. We're all learning, we're all in this process of life, we're all evolving. That is what life is about. So there's no smacked hands for not being perfect, you know, you're
that's
exactly
right,
where you
yeah.
need to be.
Yeah, great. So thinking back to your first album, Angelica, I mean, I have my particular favourites, I'm sure everybody else does. I'm not sure what your favourites are. I suppose you get attached to all of your songs, but is there any particular one that jumps out at you from the album?
Oh, they do all become like your little babies, don't they?
Yeah.
It's fun when you nurture them and work on them. But yeah, I mean, I'd say the one with the most power in it, the most juice, is Sacred.
Yes.
You know, it's the one that time and time again people will say just really got them at another level. And actually another one on the album is Worthy, which is kind of quirkier. And people say often that really, you know, they wake up with that song in their head, or they...
it's easy to hum along.
They dream it,
yeah.
Yeah. And I think the songs, though, the ones that really go a lot deeper in people are the ones that have come from a deeper place in me. So it's kind of reaching that level in others. So it's quite fascinating.
Mm.
Yeah.
I'm aware that quite a few people actually watching this interview right now may not know any of your work at all, any of your music, Muriel, would you be willing to sing something for us?
Yeah.
Would you be willing to sing part of Sacred? Oh, wonderful.
Yeah, I'll give you a taste of Sacred if you like.
Wonderful. Okay, the stage is yours.
Thank you. How would I treat myself if I thought I was sacred? How would I love myself if nothing was wrong? I'd be in the moment, enjoying what's inside, and sing to the world a glorious song. How would you treat yourself if you knew you were sacred? How would you love yourself if nothing was wrong? You'd be in the moment, enjoying what's inside, and sing to the world a glorious song.
You know, I must admit, one of my all-time favourites is Heaven. I mean, when I think of your name, your music, Heaven is the one that comes to me again and again, just one of those favourites. Could I ask you if you would do us a favour? Would you sing Heaven for us? I'm sure there are many people out there who would love to hear it too.
Yeah, of course.
Wonderful.
Yeah,
okay.
And just, I always think the fascinating thing with the song that I always remember when I sing it is I literally went into a church in France in about 2004, and I was pretty much the only person in the space, and I just asked myself, if there was a song playing here, what would it sound like? And I just heard just the high, the first note of Heaven, and then the rest just came in an instant.
Oh,
I went to, like, to the cafe next door, and on little scraps of newspaper wrote down the whole song.
Oh.
It was like it was there in its entirety in this church space. Yeah, so I
lovely.
Think of that church when I sing it.
Nice.
Heaven is not just a place in the sky. It's a home in our hearts. It's a place inside, where spirit moves in perfect grace, like an ocean of love, where the stillness of tides. You're the guest of honor in your heart, invited to the holy temple from the start. So be with your love, be with your love. Search no more, search no more, be with your love.
Now, obviously, it's really early days yet with your new album, Golden, isn't it? I mean, we've been talking a lot about the first album and about which ones are the real evergreens, the ones that people love to hear. But I was wondering if there are any particular tracks on that album that you have a particular resonance with, you know, anything that's particularly close to your heart?
There are a few. I mean, the first probably that is closest to my heart is the song called Opa, which is written for my grandfather. And even when I was, you know, I'd recorded the main vocals and I was doing just the backing vocals, I still burst into tears one afternoon singing it. It's one that just gets me in such a deep space, and so I really have to be careful when I'm singing it live that I'm in a really centered space or I could just fall apart.
Yeah.
But another one that's been a real kind of anthem for me is The River Doesn't Mind If You Cry. And it's a song that was born when I was visiting Findhorn a few years ago. And as part of Experience Week, they kind of take you to a place called Randolph's Leap. And there's a beautiful river there. And we all kind of split up and had some quiet time in different spaces. And I was, you know, not actually feeling that chirpy that day, and just a little bit so-so, like, you know, a bit under the weather, a bit gloomy, and just sitting next to the river, and I just had this really clear thought, the river doesn't mind if you cry. And I just thought it was so, so typical of how nature is there, you know, as a space to hold you and all of you and let everything be okay. And I thought it was a really beautiful sentiment at the same time. So I, you know, when we got back to the main house, I just sat at the piano and wrote the song, and it's, yeah, it feels very much like a theme for me for the last 2 years about, you know, embracing all those parts of you, including the sad ones as well as the joyful ones, and then kind of this permission to shine is really prevalent in that song and in one of the verses, and I feel like I've kind of reached more and more of that space myself over the last year or two. Personally.
Mm. You were sharing there that you got the inspiration in Findhorn. It takes me back, because I've been to Findhorn myself. Very, very beautiful, inspirational place, isn't it? Yeah, lovely. So we've been talking quite a lot about what you've been doing in the past few years, indeed what all the early influences were, Muriel, but it'd be nice to look ahead and hear perhaps what you've got lined up for the months to come. Do you have any specific plans?
Yeah, well, it looks like probably a couple of trips to European countries, maybe Germany next month, and Amsterdam, not Amsterdam, it's over in Holland though, in November, and probably singing for Amar's appearance again in London in November as well. And I really notice these things seem to really go in waves. I can have a few months of nothing on at all, and then suddenly you've got, you know, three big things within a couple of weeks of each other or something. So yeah, there's a busy period coming up again soon.
Lovely. So it's always quite easy to have plans for the weeks and months to come, isn't it? That's a sort of manageable future, so to speak. But what about really long term, Muriel? Are you able to look that far in the future? What do you think's waiting for you?
Oh, I've got a sense of general direction of kind of carrying on the paths that I'm on, and making more CDs, obviously, over the years. But I guess of what the specific ways look like in which my music is getting out there, I'm not sure at all. I think what life's shown me so far is how it's such a step at a time process that all kinds of things could be happening that I have no concept of right now. And I mean, I feel I'd love to have my music in films as a way of getting them out to a wider audience, but yeah, just wait and see really, and take each step as it comes.
Yeah, sounds good. And I know we briefly touched on the topic of you going and singing at other people's events, is that right? So would it be true to say then that you are open to people approaching you for this purpose?
Yeah, of course. I'm really open to all invitations. I mean, I've done a lot of singing at kind of large, almost conference style events in large halls with speakers, or I've also done very small kind of intimate wedding reception kind of performances as well, or during a ceremony. Yeah, I mean, whatever the occasion, if people have got the sense that my music would enhance it, I'd be very happy to consider it.
So not only you perhaps singing solo, but also combining with what's other people have on offer. So perhaps Muriel singing and some other event, that sort of setup.
Yeah, of course. Or if people want just a solo performance, that's doable as well. So I can really slot into to whatever kind of event they're thinking of creating.
Great, sounds great. So if people were interested in doing that, Muriel, what would be the best way for them to actually contact you? How could they get in touch?
Well, the website is probably the best way. You can go onto my contact page and email me from there. It's just info@murielsings.com.
Great, okay. And we will be, of course, including all of your contact details in the text that goes with this interview on the Cosmic Web, so people will make it easy for people to reach you, so to speak. Do you have any other contact details that people could perhaps use, or is it only the web?
That's the main way. I mean, you can also email me at Fortuna Music, just simply info@fortunamusic.org, That's kind of my record company email address, so.
Right, yeah. Great. Okay, we'll make sure we include that with all the other bits and pieces. Well, we seem to have come to the end of our time together, Muriel. It's been such great fun chatting to you. I really enjoyed it. And I've learned a lot about you in this time that we've chatted together. I'm sure the people watching have enjoyed it too. So hopefully we're going to share what we've talked about today with everyone else. And it would be lovely if those listening, if they feel resonance with you, for them to just get in touch, email you, get in touch any other way and take it from there.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you. It's been a real pleasure. And yeah, thanks for helping to spread the music.
You're welcome. Okay, take care, Mia.
Take care. Bye. Thanks.